And so from an LLM ops standpoint, we learned we're going to need to be able to support multiple LLMs. So we've been introducing, just listening and based on the feedback, incorporating multiple LLMs into our products. That's driven new skill sets and being able to regularly review kind of prompts. We record a quality score with each interaction. So if we need to go back to see on a particular LLM, if there's additional data that's needed to kind of improve accuracy. We've got MLOps in place. We've got LLM ops in place. We're continually improving the accuracy of these models and driving usage and adoption. That also creates challenges as well. If you've got a customer there and you're assisting them with a riding mower and navigating them through several different kind of product choices, you need an immediate response. You can't be waiting 30 seconds or a minute for a response from the LLM. So we do quite a bit in terms of performance tuning and from a continuous readiness standpoint, also making sure the platforms can scale up, especially during periods of the year that are particularly busy. So, you know, as an example, day after Thanksgiving, we see a significant volume as a retailer as customers are getting a jump start on their holiday shopping.
It's interesting you said that you had to scale up based on the inference time for those big, you know, generative AI queries. How do you prepare for that? Like, did you know when you implemented initially Askura that, okay, this is the amount of GPUs we need, this is how much we anticipate we'll need, and then all of a sudden everyone's using it and like, oh gosh, we have to really scale up. Is that what happened?
We started initially with our pilot stores, our manager advisory board stores, our district manager advisory board stores, and then started rolling out to the regions from there. So we were able to kind of gauge volumes, and then as we saw more and more adoption, work proactively in getting some additional kind of capacity and GPUs in place with our partner. But there's also been examples like with tractor vision, as we were training the computer vision models, in many cases, it requires millions of images and training. This is a tractor supply team member versus this is potentially a customer. Is a customer bringing a pet into the store? Perhaps it's a dog. We've had a wide range of other animals that have been brought into the store, goats and horses. And so we've had to train the models. We want to understand kind of foot traffic, conversion, and then also if a customer was dwelling in a particular part of the store and needed assistance, being able to identify that versus it being a team member. But there's always with this unexpected things. Like at one point, I remember when we were doing a lot of the training of the models, we had a large inflatable Santa that was at the front of the store, and the inflatable Santa was triggering alerts that there might be a customer that needs assistance. So, it just so happened at a particular store, as the inflatable Santa was moving in the wind, it was by the riding mowers, which it gave the appearance that it was dwelling near a riding mower and then triggering alert. This is where kind of your ML ops comes into play. There's additional images, things that we got to do to train the model. That's an inflatable Santa. And then we have really unique products at Tractor Supply. We've got a 6-foot rooster for each season. In Halloween, we've got a skeleton rooster. It's very unique, but we've got to make sure the models recognize that's a product versus, that's a potentially a team member or a customer. And all of that takes GPUs. And so as we were doing this at scale, there was points too. We also needed to add additional capacity and be able to develop those models.
Technology is, I don't know, has it ever been as rapidly changing it as it now? I don't think so.
Each day, your AI continues to get better and better. I mean, it's incredible the pace at which things are moving. And I think it will have implications kind of from a retail standpoint longer term as well.
Can you expand on that a little bit?
So an example might be today, a customer might be inclined to do paid search through Google or another search engine, but over time they might use their digital assistant, and these assistants are continuing to learn more about us, our preferences, and being able to give us personalized advice. And so I do think over time, there may be a trend that customers more and more use AI assistants to kind of help them They may be planning a trip. They might be planning a particular project and developing a parts list or of things that they need for their project, or just simply being able to purchase something that they might need for their pet. And so I do think we've got to keep an eye towards connectors and agents. And regardless of kind of how the customer prefers to shop, if that's through the consumer mobile app, the web, through some of these AI assistants like ChatGPT or Perplexity or Gemini or others, that we make it really easy for the customer. And then, you know, over time, as you see more use of operators, there may be a future where people are using operators to do research, and they might be looking across multiple websites to kind of research their project and then bringing back a recommendation for their purchase, and then through the operator making the purchase. And so we may be a few years out before that's getting popularity, but we've got to have an eye towards the future and making sure we've got that ecosystem of partners and connectors with those agents.